Good morning, everyone. Please rise for the presentation of the colors.
Left to right, face. Forward, march. Detail, halt. Left to right, face. Forward, march.
Good morning, everyone. Please be seated. So on behalf of the City Council and the City of Walnut Creek, I would like to welcome you to this special Memorial Day observance. Three of my colleagues are on the dais with me today, Council Members Luella Haskew, Cindy Silva, and Justin Waddell. In addition, unfortunately, Mayor Christina Lawson had a prior family commitment and could not be here, but she sends her best wishes to everyone. We are also pleased that several elected officials or their representatives are here to help us observe this important day. With us today are Assembly Member Susan Bonilla and Assembly Member Joan Buchanan. And in addition, in representing Congressman George Miller and in the, is Justin, I'm sorry, representing Senator Mark DeSaulnier is Justin Barker, and representing Karen Mitchoff is Leah Bristol. We already had the presentation of the colors. So we will now proceed with the Pledge of Allegiance, which will be led by Councilmember Luella Haskew, after which Reverend Dwayne Michael will deliver the invocation, and then I will return after that to offer some opening remarks and introduce our keynote speaker.
At a moment when we truly understand its meaning and commitment, please join me with the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Let us pray. We are humbled by the courage and sacrifice, by the discipline, the dedication, and the selfless service of all those whom we remember today. May our gathering be informed by the memory of all those who have given their lives for this country and its ideals. May today be a memorial that brings further soothing to the pain of loss that is never totally healed, both the pain of those who return and the pain of family and friends of those who don't. May today be an honoring of all veterans and all those currently serving in our armed forces. May today be an expression of thanksgiving for the many gifts of freedom and security that have been attained through the sacrifices of so many. May the words spoken, the memories and hopes shared, and the music played and sung lift our spirits and verify the sanctity of the sacrifices made by those whom we remember and honor. May we continue to fully honor and give thanks for those who serve our country. And may we continue to support their survivors, and may we always be ready to respond to the needs of our veterans and their families. Amen.
The first observation of what we call Memorial Day occurred on May 30th, 1868, when flowers were placed on the graves of Union and Confederate soldiers at Arlington National Cemetery in Virginia. The day wasn't recognized by all of the states until after World War I, when the day was changed from honoring those who died in the Civil War to those who died fighting in any war. For 26 years now, this city has held this special ceremony on Memorial Day to remember and to honor those American military personnel from all branches of services and from all wars who gave their lives in the service of our country and to preserve our freedoms. We welcome those of you who are with us here today to honor and remember those heroes who are no longer with us. It is very important that we, as a community, continue to hold a Memorial Day observance to honor these brave men and women. We can never take for granted the sacrifices made by these special Americans. In this Walnut Creek centennial year, three individuals, Cindy Silva, Jerry Whiting, and Ann Shelton, saw that our recognition of men from Walnut Creek was incomplete. While plaques identifying the men who died in the Vietnam War, Iraq, and Afghanistan wars were previously placed next to Veterans Memorial Plaza, there was no recognition of the men who had died in either of the two world wars or in the Korean War. These three individuals started a project that would identify all Walnut Creek residents who had served and died in a war since our inception in 1914. Together, they spent hundreds of hours reviewing old military records and reading old newspapers. 1914 was also the beginning of World War I. More than 10 million men died in that war, which began the bloodiest century in human history. Although the United States did not enter that war until 1917, more than 120,000 Americans were killed in that war. While every able-bodied man from Walnut Creek registered for service in that war, no person from Walnut Creek died fighting in that war. Sadly, the story is quite different for all subsequent wars. In World War II, a total of 22 men from the Army, the Army Air Forces, the Navy, the Marine Corps, and the Canadian Air Forces died. During the Korean War, a total of 10 men from the Army, the Marine Corps, and the Navy died. During the Vietnam War, a total of 17 men from the Army, the Navy, and the Marine Corps died. In 2007, one young man died in the Iraq War, and one young man died in the Afghanistan War. Both men served in the Army. After the keynote speech today, our Walnut Creek Concert Band will play Hymn for the Fallen. During the music, World War II veteran William Bill Armstrong, an Army corporal, will read the names of the soldiers from World War II that have fallen. Bill has been a resident of Walnut Creek since 1947 and retired from the Naval Weapons Station in Concord. Korean War veteran Barry Allen Kite, Navy Radio Man 3, will read the names of the Korean War fallen soldiers. Allen served in the Tactical Air Control Squadron and supported amphibious operational landings in the latter part of the Pacific War. He was also directly involved with the Army, Navy, and Marine pilots during the last years of the Korean War. Ed Calderon will read the names from the Vietnam War. Petty Officer Second Class Ed Calderon served in the Navy from 1956 to 1966. And from October 1965 to January 1966, he served in the Philippines, where his squadron serviced the carriers off Yankee Station from there to Da Nang. Bill Armstrong will then return to read the names of the Iraq and Afghanistan wars, fallen soldiers. Our keynote speaker today is Roxane Langevin. Roxane was born in Hawaii and raised in the Bay Area. She has been a Walnut Creek resident for over 30 years and is currently a vice president of client management at a benefit consulting firm in the East Bay. She has been married to Drew for 28 years and is the mother of two boys, Sean, who was killed in Afghanistan on November 9, 2007, and Scott, who is 25. The Langevins are a scouting family, and both boys earned the rank of Eagle Scout. Sean K.A. Langevin graduated from Ignatia Valley High School in 2002 and married Jessica on January 29, 2006. Roxane officiated their marriage. In February 2006, Sean went to boot camp at Fort Benning, Georgia, and completed airborne paratrooper training in July. Shortly after, he became a part of the 173rd Airborne Brigade Combat Team, known as the Sky Soldiers, in Vicenza, Italy. In May 2007, in support of Operation Enduring Freedom, the 173rd deployed to Afghanistan. Sean was killed on November 9, 2007, in an ambush attack. Sean was awarded two Purple Hearts, two Bronze Stars, one with a V device, and the Army Commendation Medal for his actions in August and November of 2007. Jessica was pregnant at the time of Sean's death. Zoe Nicole Canet was born 3 months later on February 4th, 2008. Sean's legacy lives on in Zoe, and Roxane has fun being a grandmother to a girl. We are very pleased today that Drew, Scott, Jessica, and Zoe are here with us today, and they are sitting in the front row to my right. Most recently, retired Sergeant Kyle White was awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor for his heroic actions in the same ambush attack on November 9, 2007, which took Sean's life and the life of five others. Sean and Kyle served and fought together and were best friends. Roxane and Jessica attended Kyle's Medal of Honor ceremony on May 13th at the White House. Roxane spends her time honoring the memory of Sean and the many others who sacrificed their lives for our country. She belongs to the Golden Gate Chapter of American Gold Star Mothers, an organization that provides assistance and support to veterans, active military personnel, and their families. She is a committee member for the California Run for the Fallen, a 150-mile run where every mile is run by active and retired military personnel. The run honors our post-9/11 fallen California servicemen and women. Roxane is a Gold Star mom, and we'll talk about the journey of a Gold Star mom. It is important to Roxane that we always remember and never forget our servicemen and women who have served, fought, and sacrificed their lives for our country and for our freedoms. Please welcome Roxane Langevin.
Good morning. First, I'd like to thank the City of Walnut Creek and especially Mayor Pro Tem Bob Simmons for allowing me the opportunity to fulfill my mission in honoring and remembering our servicemen and women today, especially my son, Sean. It is truly an honor and a privilege to be here with all of you. I'm Roxane Langevin, proud Gold Star mother of Army Corporal Sean Kanai Aldrich Langevin, born in Walnut Creek on August 17, 1984. and killed in an ambush attack in Iranis, Afghanistan on November 9, 2007, along with four other paratroopers and a Marine. Sean was with the 173rd Airborne Brigade Combat Team, also known as Chosen Company, in Vicenza, Italy. Not bad duty. Drew and I bestowed upon Sean the foundation of love for family, friends, and God. Sean loved to have fun, and he loved an adventure. He was an Eagle Scout with Troop 444, which had proven to provide him with the skills necessary to be a good, honorable soldier, earning two Purple Hearts, two Bronze Stars, one with Valor, the Army Commendation Medal, and other service medals such as the Global War on Terrorism, Afghanistan Campaign, and Good Conduct. As with every Gold Star family, it begins with that dreadful knock on the door, the knock that changed all of our lives. For Drew and I, we were spared the knock because we were in Portland, Oregon, for our youngest son, Scott's, last college football game of the season. Unfortunately, Jessica, Sean's wife, was not, and she had to make the toughest decision of her life, either to wait until we returned so that we too would experience what she had just gone through, or to communicate the news of Sean's death to us over the phone. She chose the latter. Whether it was a knock on the door or a phone call, it really didn't matter. I remember my heart stopping in disbelief, screaming, my legs giving out from under me, and then dropping to the ground, sobbing uncontrollably. And it killed me inside to have to tell Scott that his brother was killed. Although it's been 6.5 years since we received the tragic news, it does seem like yesterday. For all of us, me, Drew, Scott, and Jessica, as well as Zoe, a part of us was also taken. Our son, not only brother to Scott, but Scott's best friend, and Jessica's husband. And for Zoe, Sean's daughter, born 3 months after his death, she was cheated of experiencing firsthand Sean's love for family, life, friends, his country, and God. Every day I ask why. As a parent, it just isn't right for your child's life to be taken before yours. A Gold Star mom, dad, wife, husband, sibling, grandparent, uncle, aunt, nephew, niece, or cousin are family members who lost a loved one in war or died by other means while serving our country in time of war. On that very tragic day for all Gold Star families that we so vividly remember, we became a member of a club that we know no one wants to belong to. But we found that we all share a common thread, bond, and the support of each other. The enormity of the grief that our Gold Star families carry, most will never fully know. I wouldn't be able to have the same strength and courage that I have today to carry on without the love and support of my family. I am truly blessed to have the love and support not only from my family, but also my Troop 444 family, which some of them are here today as well. Blue Star moms and other Gold Star families that I've met along my journey. The loss of Sean has brought us so many other blessings, including Jessica's boyfriend, Marcus. He loves and cares for Jessica so much and has especially embraced Zoe, just like his own daughter. When I talk about him in conversation, I say, my daughter-in-law's boyfriend. Oh, and I get the strangest looks. Like, did I hear that right? He has become a part of my family as well as his family. And he too understands, and his family also understands, the importance of honoring and remembering Sean, especially for Zoe. The pain of our loss continues, Let it be in what we do every day, a song we hear or a phrase that resonates in our ears that we heard our loved ones say. There isn't a minute that goes by in a day when we're not thinking about Sean. I see, hear, and feel his presence in everything that I do. There are times I hear hear Sean in Scott's voice, either a statement, laugh, yell, gesture, or even that swat on the butt that Scott may make. And even more bizarre, Sean lives on in Zoe, and I hear and feel the same. How can that be other than a true blessing from God? Death leaves a heartache no one can heal. Love leaves a memory no one can steal. Every time there is a first or even something special for Zoe, I always think, I wish her daddy was here to see and experience this. I wonder what it would be like to see his pride in everything his daughter is doing. We all have holes in our hearts, and our only way to fill those holes is to continue Sean's legacy and memory, and to fill Zoe's heart with the memory and love of her daddy every opportunity we can, and most importantly, to honor his commitment and sacrifice to our country. I honor Sean's commitment and sacrifice to our country by being a member of the American Gold Star Mothers Golden Gate chapter. We strive to keep the memory of our sons and daughters alive by working to help veterans, active duty military, their families, and our communities. I am on the committee also for the California Run for the Fallen, which is a 150-mile run, honoring the memory of our post-9/11 California fallen heroes, where every mile, which takes place from September 26 and ends at the Dixon National Cemetery with a public 5K run or walk on September 28th. And I also participate in events such as today, Memorial Day, Veterans Day, and memorials for others who paid the ultimate sacrifice. I know Sean would have wanted me to do just this. At Sean's 6th year anniversary of his death last November 9, we finally interred his ashes at Queen of Heaven Cemetery and released doves in honor of Sean and all of his other buddies who lost their lives in the same battle and also those whose lives were spared. On May 13th this year, 2 weeks ago, President Obama awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor to former Sergeant Kyle J. White for his heroic and selfless actions during the same ambush attack in Iranis, Afghanistan, which took Sean's life. Sean and Kyle were best friends, and both Jessica and I had the honor of being a part of history and attended the ceremonies at the White House as well as the Pentagon. Up until this point, our family heard only bits and pieces of what actually happened that day. We never felt comfortable asking his fellow paratroopers the details because we wanted to make sure they were ready to share the events of that day with us. Leading up to the ceremony, there were many, many articles written about Kyle's actions on that dreadful day. I remember reading the first one to Drew from the Army Times and sobbed all the way through it. I couldn't imagine anyone having to endure what these men endured during this horrific attack. This was the first time we heard the details of what actually happened. And I now understand the trepidation they all had with this mission, the same mission that Sean called home the day before to pray for them. Jessica and I spent 3 days with Sean's fellow soldiers and paratroopers, listening to many stories, many of which were hysterically scary, especially those about the time spent at the ranch house, a secluded operating base in the northeast mountains of Afghanistan, Nuristan province. All of the guys said the ranch house, until the attack on August 22nd, 2007, was the best time they had during their deployment in Afghanistan. While eating breakfast at the hotel in DC one morning, Eric Phillips, currently a Green Beret, introduced himself to me. He fought in the same ranch house attack with Sean. Eric Phillips received the Distinguished Service Cross for his actions in this battle, where 60 to 70 Taliban insurgents attacked the ranch house post. The Distinguished Service Cross is the second highest military decoration that can be awarded to a member of the Army, and at that time, it was only the fifth awarded to a service member during Operation Enduring Freedom. During this attack, half of the 22 soldiers from the 173rd were wounded, Sean included. But no soldiers were killed in the 2.5-hour firefight, and the base was not overrun. Truly a miracle. Eric Phillips proceeded to tell me that the only reason he was able to do what he did and receive the Distinguished Service Cross was because of Sean and his efforts in holding his post. Even though another soldier ran from the same post Sean guarded and left Sean alone to defend the perimeter in keeping the insurgents from overrunning the post. This is the same attack that Jetta Deloria said that he was grateful for what Sean did, protecting him while he was severely wounded and felt he wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for Sean continuing to hold his post. Today, we have two little guys running around in honor of Sean. While in DC, Eric shared with me that he named his son after Sean. And we also have Chuck Bell, another soldier in the same attack, also named his son after Sean. I was so honored to be in the presence of such greatness and heroes, all of them. It was truly a time for all to share their stories with laughter and some with tears, one of which said, being together with everyone those few days, he felt closure. I especially enjoyed hearing the story all over again about Sean and his fellow soldiers one night running through the streets of Vicenza. Are you guys ready for this? Buck naked, with his wife Jessica holding their clothes and running after all of them. So you can only imagine some of the other stories that were told. I know these stories won't bring Sean back, but it is the next best thing for us. Those who have fallen while serving our country are not faceless people or statistics. They are someone's loved one. Lives have been sacrificed while defending our country and preserving our freedoms. They are all heroes who have paid the ultimate sacrifice. Whether they were killed in action or died by other means while serving our country, our fallen heroes answered our country's call to duty. They exemplified selflessness and patriotism that continued to define our country, our great nation, land of the free and home of the brave. And as many of you already know, their ultimate sacrifice is one we can never fully repay. However, a way in which you can, as a community and as a nation, is to never forget. You are all here because you know the importance of honoring and remembering. We wouldn't be able to freely enjoy our pastimes if not for the men and women who so valiantly fought and for those still serving and fighting for our country. Each and every time you see our red, white, and blue flag flying majestically, remember the blood, sweat, and tears of those who so valiantly served and fought for our country, and for those continuing to serve and fight for our country. President Harry S. Truman said, "Our debt to the heroic men and valiant women in the service of our country can never be repaid. They have earned our undying gratitude. America will never forget their sacrifices. And remember, freedom isn't free. Many have paid that ultimate price so that we can enjoy what we have today." As Medal of Honor recipient Kyle White said, "Being awarded the Medal of Honor gives him the chance to honor his fallen heroes, brothers." He also said that it always seems like it's always the best guys who pay the ultimate price. Their sacrifices need to be known and remembered. They gave their all that day. They fought until they couldn't anymore. I was just doing my job. It's as much their award as it is mine. I'm just going to be the one wearing it. I stand here in the presence of all of you wearing the same memory bracelet as Kyle White, honoring and remembering the chosen few paratroopers, sky soldiers, killed on November 9, 2007. Captain Matthew Ferrara, Sergeant Jeffrey Mersman, Corporal Lester Roquet, Specialist Joseph Landcor, Sergeant Philip Box, and Kyle's best friend, my son, Corporal Sean Langevin. And to all other fallen and veterans who have gone before us, we honor and remember you today. I'd also like to make sure that we also thank those who are currently in active duty, servicemen and women, as well as our veterans. And I would love you to all stand up so that we can give you, just applaud you for your thanks. Thank you all for your service. The legacy of heroes is the memory of a great name and the inheritance of a great example. May our heroes and their families always be honored and never forgotten today and every day. Thank you.
The following served with the United States Army through World War II: Sergeant Delbert J. D. Bishop, Private First Class John L. Fry, Private Theodore B. Gallagher, Sergeant Orrin E. Gray, Private First Class Robert Edgar Green, Jr., First Lieutenant Burson W. Joseph, First Lieutenant John O. Mathias, Jr., Private Francis Frank D. McCready, Private First Class Steve Piona, Jr., Private Richard Stratton. United States Army Air Forces Staff Sergeant Sidney Lawrence Bottomley, Second Lieutenant Leonard L. Dichot, Captain Cotsworth B. Head, Jr., Staff Sergeant Richard C. Henderson, Private Ford H. Myers, Corporal William S. Lorenza, Second Lieutenant Henry J. Tiedemann, Staff Sergeant Louis E. Winkler, United States Marine Corps, Private Iva Lee Gray, Jr., Private James Dutton Richards, Private First Class James B. Treadway, Corporal George E. Williams, serving with the United States Navy, Seaman Second Class Beverly Annis, Seaman Second Class Bruce Annis, Lieutenant Warner Clark Jr., Apprentice Seaman John Cluen, Fireman Second Class Morris Bradford Eakins. Radio Technician First Class Robert Vernon Hansen. Seaman First Class William Grant Jessup. Ensign Aviation George Allen Jung Johan. Ensign David Joseph Lawrence. Gunner's Mate Third Class Stephen Hosmer Norse. Radio Man First Class Aubrey E. Price. And George Teixeira, Royal Canadian Air Force Air Officer.
Fallen of the Korean War, 1950-1953, from Walnut Creek. United States Army, Private First Class Victor Proctor Beauchamp Jr., Corporal Gene Edwin Evans, Corporal Robert David Gilardi, Captain Danny Rubio Green, Private John Wesley Hansard, First Lieutenant Paul Ernst Kremser, Private Russell Alfred Moorcraft, Private Leslie D. Opp, Corporal Lloyd Thomas, United States Marine Corps, Sergeant Glenn Finley Gregg, Jr., United States Navy, Lieutenant Lewis William Seymour, Jr.
The Vietnam War, United States Army, Second Lieutenant Rene G. Ballman, Private First Class Richard Curtis, Specialist Fourth Class Wayne K. Lane, Corporal V. Ryan, Specialist Fourth Class Frank C. Torres Jr., Sergeant James P. Young, United States Marine Corps, Private First Class John P. Burke, Lance Corporal Robert S. Croak, Sergeant J. Hayes, Lance Corporal James K. Kaler, Private First Class Ernest F. Lawrence, Captain Bruce F. McMillan, Lance Corporal Willard E. Nelson, Lance Corporal David A. Oberle, Lance Corporal Robert J. Riley, Jr., Second Lieutenant David R. Turner, United States Navy, Petty Officer First Class Robert H. Burgess.
The following have perished in the Iraq and Afghanistan wars. United States Army, Specialist James J. Kuhn and Corporal Sean Langevin.
Thank you, Roxane, for sharing your journey with us and for all of your thoughtful and poignant remarks. We also wish to thank all of the Gold Star and Blue Star moms and families that are here today. Excuse me. And thank you also to Mr. Armstrong, Mr. Kite, and Mr. Calderon for reading the names of those men from Walnut Creek who died, who served and died in World War I, the Korean War, and the Vietnam War. and the Iraq and Afghanistan wars. While Memorial Day is a day to remember and honor those who have died in the service of their country, we also wish to express our appreciation to all of the wonderful veterans who have served our country and to those military personnel who are presently serving our country. Our concert band will now play Armed Forces Salute. Please stand when the anthem for your branch of the military is played.
The Army. The Coast Guard. The Marines. Navy. Thank you.
Let us pray. May the memories shared and stimulated here today always be sacred ground upon which to stand and build a strong and secure future. May every place these memories are carried be hallowed ground and a place to reflect on what they gave and what courage represents. May all who remember share a memory, a tear, or the joy of having known them. May we continue to reflect in remembrance of these men and women who went before and those who will follow. Bless all those who have come here today with the words and the music of memorial and honor. May the truth that makes us free, the hope that never dies, and the love that casts out fear lead us forward in hope, love, and peace. Amen.
Before we proceed to the Veterans Memorial Plaza, on behalf of the entire city, I want to thank the Walnut Creek Concert Band and Harvey Benstein for their performances here today. You have performed at all of our Memorial Day and Veterans Day ceremonies since 1988. You have enriched our ceremonies with your musical contribution, and we thank you very much for that. I want to again thank Roxane Langevin for sharing her journey with us and for telling us stories about her son. It really made this day more meaningful and more moving. We also thank Reverend Dwayne Michael for his invocation and his blessing. We are grateful for the Navy for taking time to be part of this special tribute. And we wish to give thanks also to the Rotary Club of Walnut Creek for assisting with today's ceremony, and to Cub Scout Troop 302, Dens 1 and 5, for their assistance with the planning. I also want to thank our city staff for all of their work to support today's ceremony, and specifically a call out to our Public Works Department for their beautiful work installing the plaques that we will soon see. Finally, I want to thank you all again for being here today to honor and remember those who have died in the service of their country. President William McKinley, who was the last veteran of the American Civil War to be elected president, reminded us, and I quote, "Let us ever remember our interest is in concord, not in conflict, and that our real eminence as a nation lies in the victories of peace, not those of war." In the next couple of weeks, a large statue will be erected between the gazebo and the library behind me. It is called the Hand of Peace. The statue is an open hand figure with stained glass around the fingers and a mural in the middle of the palm featuring a group of children. Above them, the inscription reads, "The children of the world shall inherit the earth." Sometimes war is necessary to preserve our peace and to preserve our freedom. Let us always remember the sacrifices of those that have made our existence here possible. But let us also strive, and let us also strive to make sure that the world our children inherit will be a world of peace. We'd like you now to follow us over as we proceed to the Veterans Memorial Plaza. And for the placing of the wreath, after which we will observe a moment of silence before the playing of taps and the lowering of the flag to half staff. Please feel welcome to join us in that part of the ceremony. After that, we will proceed to the John Nedgedly Redwood Grove, immediately adjacent to the Veterans Memorial Plaza, where we will unveil the plaques. Please follow us now. Thank you. Thank you all for coming over here to the unveiling of the plaques. I want to give a special thank you to Cindy Silva, Jerry Whiting, and Ann Shelton for the many hours that they spent identifying the men that had died, that had lived in Walnut Creek and had died in these wars. They have given us something not just for this, our centennial year, but for many years to come, and for that we are very grateful. I have asked Councilmember Silva to offer a few remarks based on her research.
So we'll see if this works. By the time Walnut Creek residents voted to become a city in October 1914, Europe had been engulfed in the World War I for nearly 3 months. For the next 3 years, Walnut Creek residents read about the war raging in the trenches of France. But of course, it was 5,500 miles away, and it really wasn't something that was affecting their everyday lives. Then, on April 6th, 1917, the United States entered World War I, and men all across the United States were called up to register for the draft. In Walnut Creek, nearly 100 men registered for the draft in early June of 1917, including four brothers of the Stowe family, two brothers of the Cameron family, which owned the blacksmith shop at Mount Diablo and Main Street, and Lester Lawrence, the fourth Lawrence brother, and the one who eventually established car dealerships in Walnut Creek. By November 11, 1918, Armistice Day, 4 million American men had fought in World War I, and nearly 120,000 had lost their lives, including 77 in Contra Costa County, whose names are memorialized on the monument in Pleasant Hill. Fortunately, all of Walnut Creek's young men came home, but we honor and remember them all who lost their lives in World War I, the Great War, with this plaque. It reads, in memory of those who gave their lives in service to their country, World War I, 1914 to 1918. Most of Walnut Creek's World War I veterans actually came home to Walnut Creek. They were merchants and dairy farmers. They were bankers and plumbers and carpenters. And of course, no one wanted another war. But within 20 years, the winds of war were once again blowing, this time not only in Europe, but in the Pacific. From 1941 through 1945, the pages of the weekly Walnut Creek Colonel newspaper were filled with stories of Walnut Creek's involvement in World War II. In Italy, in France, in Belgium, over Germany, in North Africa, in the Philippines, on Iwo Jima. And sadly, there were stories of loss. Mr. Armstrong, if you could please. Among Walnut Creek's losses were members of all four branches of the armed services, including in the United States Navy, the Honest Twins, Bruce and Beverly. Born and raised in Walnut Creek, they lost their lives on the same day in 1942 because they were serving on the same Navy tanker that was involved in the Battle of the Coral Sea. In the Army, First Lieutenant Burson Joseph was killed in action in France. He was part of the 7th Army's campaign to liberate 660 French villages and towns in 1944 from German control. Iva Gray was among the Marine casualties on Iwo Jima. Army Air Force's Corporal William Presenza lost his life while he was a POW in Manchuria. Navy Ensign David Lawrence was killed when his training aircraft crashed. He was the youngest son of Joseph Lawrence, Walnut Creek's second mayor, and one of the founders of the Lawrence Meat Market. Canadian Air Officer George Tatara was lost following a bombing raid over Cologne. And Maurice Eakins was serving on the ill-fated USS Indianapolis. After delivering the atom bombs to Tinian in July 1945, the Indianapolis was cruising to meet the rest of the U.S. fleet off the Gulf of Leyte in preparation for the invasion of Japan. The Indianapolis was suddenly torpedoed, and it sank in 14 minutes. 300 were lost in the original attack, and 600 others were lost over the next 5 days as they were in the water, waiting to be rescued while the Navy was under silence. By the time the Japanese surrendered in September 1945, Walnut Creek had lost 34 young men, graduates of Occalani's and Mount Diablo High School, members of our local churches, St. Mary's, Walnut Creek Presbyterian, St. Paul's Episcopal, Walnut Creek United Methodist. They were active in Demolay. They were members of our community. We honor and remember all of these brave men with these plaques. It was no more than 5 years later, in the summer of 1950, when we once again were called to war, this time in Korea, and Walnut Creek once again made the ultimate sacrifice. Among our losses were Paul Kremser, who was a mortar platoon leader in the 2nd Infantry Division. He'd been occupying a hill by the Mactong River when he was surrounded by superior enemy forces. He held off the enemy for 4 days, but he ultimately died in a mortar burst. Glenn Gregg was killed while fighting the enemy door to door in Seoul, Korea. And Robert Gilardi, member of the Army Airborne Infantry Combat Team, was killed from wounds that he received while in North Korea. 3 years in Korea, 11 Walnut Creek men lost. This plaque pays tribute to them and all of those who made this sacrifice, the ultimate sacrifice, on all of our behalfs.
Let us pray. Eternal Spirit, may we always remember the thousands who gave their lives in these wars. We thank you for these eternal reminders that no war should ever be forgotten nor overlooked. We give thanks that these plaques will constantly acknowledge that when men and women talk in some distant time with remembrance of these wars, the shining deeds of those who fought and those who died will live. May these plaques be one of the many ways in which the measures of their sacrifices are enshrined for all time. May God bless those who gave all in these wars. May God bless you and your families. May God bless the alliances that help secure our prosperity and our security. May God continue to bless these United States of America. Amen.
Thank you, Councilmember Silva and Reverend Dwayne Michael.
This does conclude our ceremony today. I would only ask that as you come down to this part of the city and are walking around, you take a moment to come by these plaques and reflect for a moment on the benefits and the freedoms that we have, to which we owe a lot to the men and the families who gave this sacrifice for us. So thank you very much for being here.
And have a good day.
Thank you for all your help.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
I'd like to say it was an honor for me to be able to do it.